So I'm Molly Southwood. I'm Deputy Director of Development at Bath. I've been at the University of Bath for nearly 9 years now. And I have a remit that includes alumni relations, so mentoring and volunteering, international engagement, communications and events, as well as a regular giving and development services team. So quite a broad remit, but it allows me to kind of bring together a lot of the different pieces that you wind up needing when you're developing a mentoring program. We've had some great sessions, and I know some really good ones to come about kind of the nitty-gritty of mentoring programs, but I'm going to speak a little bit on a broader topic, which is about engaging international alumni. So what I thought I would do today is talk a little bit about the issues in a kind of broad sense, some of the threats and opportunities that come up when you're dealing with these groups, how do we identify them, and then what can we do about them. I'm going to give a brief overview of the approach we take engaging international constituents at Bath. And then you've all got some worksheets on the table. I think we could do a little bit of a group exercise, very non-threatening. And finish off just kind of discussing some of the issues that brought up. So this is quite a big issue. And I'm aware that there's representation from lots of different, we've got some universities. Is anyone here not from a university? Is that of interest? Okay, so that's right. Sometimes there's schools involved and that can add to the mix. But what I thought would be helpful for me as we're working through is to know the kinds of things that you might be interested in covering in a session like this. So is there anything that you particularly would hope to learn or to discuss or anything that you're dealing with at your institution? It's early, but you might have some ideas. Anybody? Okay, well that's fine. Oh yeah, come on.
I think what we do is pretty generic for our clients, but what you can do to kind of tailor it. Do you mean in the sense of different countries or just generally?
Okay. Okay, I'm just going to write this up so I can remind myself again. Anyone else got anything? No? Okay, that's fine. Right, so international. So UK higher education is still a valuable product. We're all aware, presumably at our institutions, that the number of students is fluctuating, increasing. So the last PISA data shows that from a peak in 2012-13, student numbers are kind of ups and down a little bit. And at Bath, we're having some issues with reaching our recruitment targets in terms of where we were last year. But the non-UK student numbers have actually only increased. Not a massive increase, but it's still an increasing trend. So, and that's students. So obviously, as the years go by, our alumni numbers will increase. At Bath, we have around 30% of our alumni community that outside the UK. So that's a sizable chunk, it's around just over 30,000 people. So it's a big group of people for us, and one that we really don't want to ignore. For us and for the rest of the UK, most of the students come from China, which can present its own issues in terms of how do we actually access them. They can't watch the videos we post on YouTube. They can't join our Facebook groups for the most part. So how do we get in touch with them? So what are some of the threats dealing with international constituents? Obviously different cultures have different expectations. So again, China's a big group for us. Their concepts of volunteering in China can be really different. The idea of doing something for free just out of altruism can be a little bit different. Often we find, particularly with our younger alumni, when we ask them to volunteer, that they sort of they expect some remuneration. We had an interesting exchange when I was in China in the autumn, where we invited a recent graduate to come and help us at an event to get our A badges, something very exciting. And then when she left, she said she kind of stood around and she was expecting payment. And fortunately, we kind of prepared for that, but we wouldn't necessarily get that in the US or in the UK. So there can be totally different culture expectations. Understanding those is important. It's expensive. It can be very expensive to keep in touch with international groups. We've recently gone through, so we post out a hard copy magazine once a year. On average, it costs us about £1 a graduate, so the 100,000 graduates, that gets pricey. And posting overseas is obviously even more expensive. So when we're talking about things like mentoring packs or direct mail fundraising, it all adds up. So it's, you know, it's an expensive group of people to reach. I mentioned before, but accessing different platforms can be tricky. So YouTube isn't available in China, nor is Facebook, certainly not on a regular basis. I don't know if anyone else has tried this, but we had an exciting time uploading our videos onto Baidu, which is Chinese YouTube, and trying to navigate the Mandarin instructions. So that was, you know, trying to find a way that we can share the, you know, the videos that we pay a lot of money to develop. How can we share those with our alumni in different countries? And of course, there's an expense around hosting events as well. So we run a successful series of networking events for our recent graduates, which are very cheap to run. We hold them in a bar in London, and they cost us between £500 and £1,000 each time. But if we want to do that overseas, not only do we have the expense of finding a venue that's reasonable and professional, but also getting someone there. So all the cost increases. And these are all issues we have to deal with. But like I said, for us, it's a big group. I'm sure for a lot of you as well, you have big groups of international constituents that you need to think about. But there's some opportunities as well, and they're a group that's worth engaging with. So what we found with our graduates, and some of this is from anecdotal evidence, some of this is from surveys, the impact of studying in the UK and the degree they did with you might actually be greater than for a UK student. So it can often be a family decision to up sticks and move away for a year or several years, going to a new country, and they can have a real emotional attachment to that time of their life, possibly more so than UK students. They've had to pay a lot of money, so they're probably going to be from families that have some money, so they're a good group in terms of fundraising prospects. And one of the things that we found particularly, and this is true of our African graduates, they can often be in places that we can't. So about 5 years ago, there was a security issue traveling to Nigeria, and there was a British Council exhibition that the university was due to attend. And the materials had all gone out. But the international recruitment officer couldn't travel because of the security issues. So, but we had graduates there who were willing to step in and stand. And that's not just true of places where it might be, you know, dangerous to travel, but places where it's just not worth the expense of getting a member of staff there. So the US is another example where we spend quite a lot of time on the coast, but there are still plenty of this, a lot of people in the middle, and having someone who can represent the university in those areas is really important. So the group of international alumni can provide a lot of solutions to a lot of issues that the institution might be facing. So at Bath, we realized maybe 5 or 6 years ago that we had a bit of a problem. We knew, because we do a fair amount of traveling within our department, that our graduates, they were putting their hands up all over the world and asking to get involved. They really wanted to do something. We were doing our best. We were hosting a lot of social dinners. We had around 13 or 14 active chapters who would host social events. But what we were hearing over and over again from alumni was, we want to do something meaningful. We're sick of these social events. We get together, we see the same people we saw a few months ago, or we meet with your recruitment officer, but we don't ever get involved in actually supporting the university in any meaningful way. And so we realized that was something we had to address. So we now have kind of four strands to our engagement approach in working with our international alumni. We have international alumni networks, so those 13 or 14 chapters, with a few notable exceptions, have more or less dissolved, but we now have networks in around 18 different centers, maybe. It's probably 18 countries and about 25 different kind of centers. So actually, the reach of our international volunteers is wider, even though our chapters have largely kind of dissipated. We host a number of employability events, and this has been a great opportunity to use some of that enthusiasm to offer practical support from our international alumni. We also encourage our academics to engage when they're traveling, and I'll talk a little bit more about what that looks like in a minute. And finally, and most excitingly, we have started using our alumni to support our recruitment activities. And this is something that's been really key for the university, something we've pushed for a long time. Our alumni really did want to get involved. They wanted to shout about how great the university was, but we just weren't given the tools to do it. And now we've got ourselves in a position where they can do that job for us. And with any luck, as a result, it's more students decided to come to study it after.
So just to explore those strands a little bit further, so chapters versus networks.
This was a bit of a difficult decision for us. Our chapters were very strong. They were very useful in things like management school rankings to have strong chapters in different countries. However, they take a lot of work. Volunteer management was really difficult. So we would have a chapter, and we would set them up in Malaysia, for instance, with 10 different posts, a president, a vice president, a social secretary, membership secretary, and then somebody would have a baby, or they would decide that they were moving to a different city, and that role would be empty, and we'd have to find something else. And even in places like Malaysia, where we have thousands of alumni, people really struggling to manage that volunteering offer. So what we've landed on instead is what we call networks, where we might have one or two engaged alumni in a particular area who act as our representatives when we need them. So if we're traveling to a place, and Malaysia's a very good example, where we might, academic might be traveling and hosting an event, we can call on those people to come and support us at an event. If they want to run a social event, that's fine. But there's no expectations. We don't say you've got to do an event every quarter. We don't ask them to maintain lists of their members or to send out regular updates. There's no expectations. They give us as much time as they can, and we ask them for what we need. And actually, that system has worked much better. We have a higher number of engaged volunteers because what we're asking, and I've said this before in different volunteering sessions, that volunteers will very quickly see if you're asking for things that you don't need, and they won't really engage. Now what we try and do is only ask for our international volunteers to get involved when there is actually a real need. The avoiding the kind of set, you know, you have to do an event every spring or there's always a summer barbecue, it means that we enable ourselves to have more meaningful events. So when there is a real strong opportunity for engagement, we can focus on that. If the vice chancellor is traveling or if a particular academic is traveling, or one of our colleagues in development is going to a particular city, we can use that opportunity to engage more meaningfully. We do have some chapters where they have a strong volunteer who's still in post. We haven't stopped them. We can carry on letting them develop. The top photo is probably a little blurry. That's our Beijing chapter, who, with our vice chancellor. That was a trip in October. That's actually the event where I had the awkward exchange with the volunteer that wanted pay. They are the chapter leader. There is very engaged. She's very keen on remaining a chapter, and that's fine. And we support her to do that. We also have a chapter in Athens and another in Hong Kong where they're very engaged and they have clear goals. But other places, the bottom photo is in Malaysia, where we had an alum wanted to do a sort of business development talk, and it was really well attended. And then the middle photo is in Paris, where we just have a really informal network. And every once in a while, somebody will be traveling, and we invite our students who are on placement in Paris and our alumni, and everyone gets together, and it is pretty informal. But we try and organize those events so that we're encouraging alumni to join us when the placement students arrive, so there's a real kind of focus to the event. Come and welcome the new placement students to your city. Employability, so this is a buzzword for us, and probably for a lot of you as well. I know a lot of you are representing careers departments. How do we help these students get jobs? International students can be a really difficult group to support in terms of their career development. We realized very quickly that it's hard to have in our careers team. We have a careers advisor who's dedicated to international students, but that covers a lot of countries. We have students from over 100 different countries at Bath, so we can't expect one individual to be an expert on the job markets in 100 different countries. But what we can do is expect our alumni to be experts in those areas. So we have, I mentioned, a successful networking series of events, which we call Get Connected, and we've taken those overseas. Not to 100 different countries, sadly, yet, but in countries where we have higher concentrations of alumni, or particularly young alumni. So you'll see when we go to the workshop that one thing that's very clear is the countries where you have highest numbers of alumni are not necessarily where your highest numbers of students are coming from. So for us, for instance, India, in terms of number of alumni, is probably down around 7 or 8, but it's actually number 2 in terms of how many students we have from India. So in time, the number of alumni, where it falls in the rankings of alumni numbers will shift. But for now, it certainly wasn't particularly on our radar in terms of engagement. It's a difficult country to fundraise from. But we've made it a focus for us because the rest of the university is focusing there. And again, that comes back to encouraging alumni to do a role or to support us in a way that is actually meaningful to the university. So the Get Connected events are a sort of entry to the sort of mentoring light. At an event, we have usually a number of alumni who will have one-to-one chats with the students or recent graduates. And they come along and sign up, and it's like speed networking. But it's really popular, really successful, very cheap, very easy to run, and allows us to engage with kind of big numbers of students and alumni in a really meaningful way. And taking those overseas is really fun. And how each culture does those approaches it slightly differently. So that's really cool. And we're also seeing higher numbers of events. So where we were having purely social events, a recruitment officer was taking all the alumni in the city out to dinner, and the numbers were just dwindling. We're actually now seeing turnouts of kind of 50 or 60 at these types of events, which is great. So the university awareness raising, this is a new area for us as well. It's something we trialled in a couple of places initially with a member of the development team on hand, and we're now sort of loosening control a little. So our academics, and I'm sure yours, are traveling over the world all the time to speak at conferences. We've run a few different master's courses where there are master classes offered in different areas, and we've got one actually in the next week in New York. And so what we've tried to start doing is work with those academics to make sure that alumni can be invited to those sessions. And although this kind of strays from the mentoring focus, what it does is keeps alumni engaged with what's going on in the university. And when we initially started doing this, so the first time we did it, we were attending a British Council fair in Athens, and we had a strong alumni network, so I had gone along. And there was an academic from the School of Management, so a business academic, his research area is supply chain. And he was our academic, and I said, well, can you do a talk? Now in Greece we have a fairly balanced, our alumni fairly balanced across our academic areas, and only about a quarter of them come from our business school. I was thinking, is this going to work? Can he keep his talk broad enough to appeal to our engineering graduates? And actually it was fantastic. He talked for 20 minutes. It was about the supply chain. It was actually pretty cool. And everybody loved it, and they felt great because they were learning, they thought they were getting some inside kind of academic teaching, and they got to see a little bit about the way teaching is done here. This is a good academic, he'd been chosen to go to the fair because he's engaging, he's fun, he's nice, and it worked really well, and we've started kind of taking that around a little bit, and what we've really found is that alumni aren't usually that fussed about whether it's their subject area or another subject area. And actually they just like the opportunity, particularly in areas where we don't get to go as often, they just enjoy the opportunity to engage with the university. And that gives them a bit of brand awareness, and again, empowers them to talk a bit more about the things we do at Bath. So if they've just seen a talk by one of our researchers, they can then go and talk to their friends. We encourage them to bring, I've realized when I was reading this slide, we encourage them to bring their children. I don't mean small children, I mean their teenage children who are considering university themselves. But they're always very open events, and they tend to follow whatever format is already taking place. So if it's a conference and there's coffee after, or, you know, so we and because of that, they end up being not very much work for us. So this has been a really, we're still taking baby steps, but this has been a really good move for us. part of the reason it's possible is because we're visible as well. So we spend a lot of time talking around the university, outside of the development office, working out who goes where, who can help us, where can we do those things. And then our last and our newest project, recruitment ambassadors. So this is really exciting. And Daniel and Louise and everybody else that you know, really aware of it. It's been a long time coming. But this comes from conversations we had with alumni going back 5 or 6 years, where they were saying to us, you know, I would love to be able to encourage more people to come to Bath. Or, you know, my colleague's 17-year-old daughter is thinking about studying in the UK, but I can't, you know, how can she find out about Bath? What can I tell her? And our recruitment team were very, very tentative. They were unsure. They were worried that our alumni would give wrong information. They were very worried that graduates left so long ago that they wouldn't have the right memories, that the information they had would be out of date. And we sort of kept pushing them and said, you know, it's going to be fine, it's going to be great, let's give them the information they need. You're worried that they don't know what the course is like now? Well, let's tell them what the course is like now. We have a prospectus, let's share it with them. And what we've landed on now, we have the Alumni platform for mentoring, or networking, as we call it. And we've now got the ambassador platform so that our mentors, our alumni mentors, can now add an extra tab onto their profiles, which the ambassador tab, and those tabs will be visible to our offer holders. So students who have been made an offer to study at Bath but have not yet firmly accepted their place will be encouraged to log onto the system and access those alumni. And what we're expecting, we'll hopefully launch to students next week, what we are expecting is that some will connect and ask questions, you know, how cold is it? I'm a Muslim woman from Nigeria, you know, is it safe? Those types of things. Other people might just want to see what careers people go to from that. So it's quite exciting. We have a target of around 50, maybe 100, I don't know, of in place before we launch to the students, and then we'll see where we go from there. But I know Jean was saying yesterday, like, I can't agree enough. We just don't know how it's going to work, and until we've kind of got it rolling, it's hard. And it's a bit chicken and egg, you know, you don't want so many ambassadors that nobody's going to use, but at the same time, if you don't have enough there, the students don't want to engage with the system. So we're creeping forward, but it's very exciting. We've had the initial invitation to our alumni resulted in about 10% take up, which is great, and we're delighted with that. So if we can count on that trend, we'll be in a really strong position. So what's next? So where do we go from here? So we, you know, I'm speaking today because I'm quite proud of what we offer to our international constituents. But what happens next? So we have a lot of targets around, like I said, the ambassador program. It'll be interesting to see what happens with that in terms of the outcomes. So how many of those offer holders are then converting and actually dropping out on campus? And that's going to be a really kind of a longer term goal. We have some work to do around tightening up our international networks. We also have a new senior member of staff with an international remit, so it'll be really interesting to see what ideas and thoughts he brings to the table as well. But essentially, you know, the world is our oyster, and we're looking forward to engaging more of our alumni overseas. So what I thought we'd do now is to have a chat about your tables around some challenges that you might have facing you in terms of international engagement. I would imagine, I'm guessing, if you're at very different stages in your development of programs. So what I would suggest for time, we've all got the sheet to have a think about, and those are really just some questions to get thinking. What would be great if you fill it in. If you know the answer, fantastic. If you don't, where can you look or who can you ask? Like I said, we spend a lot of time trying to be very visible within the university. Have a little chat. What I hoped to do was maybe have each group come up with one issue to kind of hash out. So if somebody's got something that's particularly troubling you in your team, or if you're working on a program that's kind of stuck in development, or even if you've got something that's really well developed and you just want to take it to the next level, maybe pick one between your tables that you can hash out a little bit. I'm not sure if time will allow, but if we've got some time, maybe we can also have a little discussion about those in the room and see if we can come up with some ideas that might help. So have a look at the sheet. I'll kind of wander around and maybe give you some leading questions. And I'll come back in about probably 5 minutes or so, and we can